Okay, so welcome everybody. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Sam and I'm the account executive for the Benelux region at Jerox. Now for the people who don't know Jerox, Jerox is the most adaptable enterprise performance management platform available in the market. And we have been working very closely with our business partner ION, specifically on sales and operations planning. Now today we are presenting our webinar called Boost High Quality Decision Making in Your S&OP with Advanced Analytics as a Service. And it's going to be presented by Joost Rommer. Joost will give a presentation that should give you more insight in how to maximize the benefits of your sales and operations planning by embedding a smart touch planning process, how to increase the focus and value of your planning team and drive better decisions easier and faster. And lastly, how leveraging all data with an advanced analytics platform connected to the Jerox platform can rapidly transform your planners and organization to the next planning level. Now, without further ado, I'm turning it over to you.
Thanks, Sam. Thanks also for the opportunity to join this webinar of today. Before going into content, let me quickly introduce myself. Joost, I'm one of the lead consultants at ION. Specialist in supporting companies to step up in their supply chain planning processes, but also in integrated business planning. Within ION, I'm one of the lead consultants, working there for more than 15 years. I have a background in consumer electronics, high-tech equipment manufacturing, and in that sense, always been balancing practice also with concepts. I think the story of today will be an interesting one. It will be on how to boost high quality decision making in your sales and operations planning processes, but also how to make that step from S&OP into truly integrated business planning. Before diving into content, a bit on practicalities, request to mute your sound. And if your sound is not working, please connect your earplugs. If you have any questions during the webinar, please raise them in the question bar. And know that after my introduction of, let's say, 30 minutes, we will have time for an extensive Q&A at the end of the presentation. Topics of today. I will kick off with a brief introduction on ION Planning Services, the company, but also the concept of Advanced Analytics as a Service. Then I will zoom in on what does it take to come to high quality decision making and what are typically the challenges that large multinational companies see? How can you boost business performance with smart touch planning? And big part of the presentation, I will zoom in on a specific case study that is the IBP journey of AkzoNobel and how they accelerated the IBP journey, making use of advanced analytics as a service together with Jerox. And as said, we close off with the Q&A part. Now, let me quickly start with introducing planning services. Planning services is one of the five pillars of ION. ION started once as a consultancy company, but today also a lot in data science, planning solutions, and also even in the academy side. Planning services is the pillar where we support companies by delivering a best possible forecast, optimize supply and inventory parameters, and also end-to-end S&OP insights. So planning services offers those advanced analytics as a service. And typically we do that in three domains: forecasting and demand management, where it's about delivering a best possible forecast based on internal or external data, using latest on statistics and machine learning. It's in the inventory side and supply optimization to optimize supply plans, single multi-echelon inventory settings, using tailored analytics to make sure also that the cash conversion, for instance, improves. And the last one, end-to-end S&OP insights, where we turn data into powerful visualizations that help companies, both planners as well as on the managerial level, to facilitate fast decision making. The core of the planning services proposition is that we build and offer a solution We realize that within a short time frame, and then we operate those services on your behalf for a specific period of time. That gives you the opportunity to bring your planning capability to the next level at your own pace. But at the same time, you can already start harvesting the business benefits right from the start. We're active in different industries where we also know the specific dynamics of those industries. And you see them listed out on this this slide. The life science industry, the high-tech industry, the process industry, consumer products, and recently we also entered the logistics domain. So what's the core and what do we deliver? Typically, companies engage, connect with these advanced analytics as a service at the moment they face specific supply chain planning challenges or business planning challenges. They suffer from poor performance or heavy workload with the planners, or they lack end-to-end visibility, for instance, because they have a scattered IT landscape after a number of mergers and acquisitions, for instance. In those cases, we lighten their load. And we do that by improving forecast accuracy, 10 to 15 percentage points. We reduce inventory levels, 20 to 25%. We improve the effectiveness and the efficiency in the planning by typically automating, let's say, 2/3 of the portfolio, which enables the company, the organization, to focus on only 1/3 of the items they need to plan. And all this we implement within a short period of time, within 10 weeks from proof of concept to go live. And actually, this is a kind of service we already offer for many years. Reflecting on the past year, we're covering 25 billion in yearly revenue. We are handling millions of planning items, covering sales in over 100 countries. And on a daily basis, we process a huge amount of data. Well, that's in short about planning services as one of the pillars of AION. Well, let's then move to the topic of today, how to boost high quality decision making in your S&OP, in your integrated business plan. And as you already can see on this picture, we are living in a time that's full of dynamics and uncertainties. And those dynamics and uncertainties bring specific challenges. It's also a time where it's all about effective decision making. And effective decision making in that sense is at the base of a sales and operations planning process. It's also at the base of an integrated business planning process. It's all about, okay, how do I make sure that my demand matches my, or that my supply matches my demand? And also to make that translation, okay, but what does that mean in terms of business revenue or profitability? And are we on track to realize the strategic ambitions that we have? If we reflect on the conversations that we have met the companies we speak to, we actually see that there are three main challenges that need to be overcome to really come to effective decision making. And the first one, I would call the first challenge is speed is really key in decision making in today's supply chain. Well, let's have a look at this graph. How we should read this is, suppose something happens in the market, a business event. Then the question is, how long does it take you to decide on a corrective action? And in principle, we state there are three stages in between. The first one is that you need to sense that something has happened, has changed, that you get your data ready for analysis. That's what we call the capture latency. The second one is that you need to turn your data into actionable insights, analysis latency. And then the third one, you still need to feed those actionable insights into a decision-making process and make sure that you really take a decision. That's a decision latency. What we see in many companies that actually it takes too long before a decision is being made. And as a consequence, the value of a decision or the impact that a decision still has on your business performance is limited. So what you would like to achieve actually is that you are capable to sense more quickly what happened, to turn data into actionable insights in a more fast way, and also feed it immediately into your decision-making process. And in that way, the value or the impact of your decision on actual business performance is much higher. That's challenge one. The second challenge that we see is that we're living in a world full of information, and there's data all around us. But more information is not automatically better. It's very important to get a clear picture on what are the relevant drivers of my business? What are the relevant insights that I need to steer my business? And in practice, we quite often see that companies work with too much information, and as systems, but also people, have limited processing capacity, that results in suboptimal decision making in their S&OP. The last one is about where do people spend their time in the integrated business planning cycle. It's all about creating meaningful jobs for planners, where you would like to focus them on value-adding activities. And what we observe is that today, still many planners execute transactional activities. They maintain planning parameters in the planning systems, they are populating Excels to discuss plans with sales and other stakeholders in the company. They need to open and use several systems to retrieve information, a lot of double work. What you would like to do is that they can increase the share of their value-adding activities, where they really steer the business, where they explore different scenarios in S&OP, find ways to further optimize revenue, to increase profitability, or to improve cash conversion. Well, finding that balance is really important. And we also see today, especially with the big war on talent that's going on, that you want to make sure that the share of value-adding activities of your planners keeps on growing. Then 2-3 years ago, we did some benchmarking on but how are decisions made in an S&OP cycle? And what we saw, what we observed, was that actually in many cases, decisions are not always based on facts or data analysis. Actually, it's the other way around. In many cases, S&OP decisions are still based on intuition, personal experience, consultation with others, and only to a lesser extent based on simple data and facts, or even advanced data analysis. Interesting to see in this graph, you also see somewhere in the middle that part of the decisions are based on the HIPPO. And what do we mean with the HIPPO? Actually, with the HIPPO, we mean the highest person personal opinion. So that also shows that having an open and transparent communication on what do we think the real plan will be, where do we see gaps, and how can we close that gap, which decisions do we need to take, that sometimes also can be influenced. So where to go? As said, the direction that we see going forward is that planner activities are getting focused there where it adds most value. And what we do in the practice of planning services is that quite often we look at product portfolios that companies offer in the market, and we start to segment them. And we split them typically in grids that you see on the left side of this picture. We look at new products, we look at products that are end of life, And we look at products that we labeled as mature, products that are in the portfolio for quite some time already and also will remain in the portfolio for quite some time. And within that mature part of the portfolio, you also can look at specific demand characteristics or how important is my product to the business. And ABC we typically use as an indication of importance to the business, XYZ as a driver for predictability or demand volatility. What you see in this example is that, and those are the green gray boxes, that for part of the portfolio, it's wise to make use of statistics in a simple way or more advanced. And by letting that part of the portfolio being planned by statistics, you can free up valuable time by planners to focus on those domains where statistics in general will not give a high quality forecast. Another interesting part is what you see on the right side of this picture is you also want to make sure that planners focus on changes to a plan, especially when you start from a baseline forecast generated with statistics, that they focus on changes that are relevant. And relevant changes are quite often substantial changes. Changes to a plan where, for instance, you decide to lower volume with more than 50% or to double volume. In practice, we quite often see that most of the changes being made to a plan, and that's what you see in this histogram, are rather small changes, a few percent up, a few percent down. And you could ask yourself, especially in a world that's very uncertain and dynamic, what is the added value of making those very small changes to a plan? Is that something we want to allow? Is that something we want to stimulate? Or should we steer planning behavior in another way that focuses only on making relevant changes to a plan? But that's basically how we came to the vision, what we call smart touch planning. A smart touch planning solution enables companies to drive better decisions easier and faster. And the core of smart touch planning are the three bullets that you see at the bottom of this page. Automate the obvious, recommend the probable, and flag where human intervention is required. Those three elements together make a smart touch planning solution. And if you would reflect that more into an architecture picture, then it would look like the flow you see at the top. Different data sources coming into your planning environment, where you need a data engineering skill to combine data sources, where you need feature engineering to identify the relevant drivers of your business and make sure that you also start planning on those drivers, where you have the expertise to select the right statistical models, analytical models, to, for instance, generate a statistical projection for the future, but also a block where there is the true planner interaction, where you ask planners to enrich an initial baseline plan based on specific insights they have in market intelligence. And the last block, that's about cognitive insights, steering planning behavior, making sure that also planners get aware on how they add value to the plan and how they can improve that. Well, actually, this principle is something we are implementing step by step with the companies we work for.
Joost?
Yep.
Good stuff. Thank you. We have a question in the question box, and I think it's if you go two slides back, where the percentage changes were mentioned. Yes, thank you. So the question is, those percentage changes shown, are those at the lowest level? So at the SKU level, SKU level, or on a higher level?
Yeah, good question. How this is measured is typically on the lower level, on a more detailed level. So changes made to individual items. But we also quite often see that also on a higher level, more consolidated level, you should ask yourself the question, okay, but what is relevant to know? And to what extent do I want to change, wants to my plan on that level? I hope that answers the question. Let me go back to the smart touch planning part. Last year, we asked companies, if you see the smart touch planning vision, what is holding you back to move this direction? And actually, the answer to this you see reflected in this graph. Most of them said, we lack the tooling. Second, we lack the experience to make use of the data. We miss the knowledge also to model it in the right way. And to a lesser extent, it was about business case or having the right data available. And that's interesting to know, because that also connects again to that proposition of advanced analytics as a service. If you would look to your value chain, and that's something you see reflected at the bottom part of this picture. Most companies run their operations making use of an ERP system. That takes care of the day-to-day operations in that value chain. Also, part of them have an advanced planning system on top of that, which takes care of the specific planning activities that you need to make that midterm and long-term term forecast to run your IBP process, for instance. But if you lack specific analytics, especially advanced analytics still in that APS layer, you might put an advanced analytics layer on top of, or as Gartner calls it, a system of innovation. And that's something you can set up yourself. It's also something that you can connect to with external parties. So the planning services we offer are typically such a system of innovation, a system that you connect with your APS and ERP layer that you use to collect data, to segment portfolios, calculate safety stocks, or generate S&OP insights. It's something you can implement in weeks. It allows you to gain business benefits from the start. And it also gives you the opportunity to build internal advanced analytics capabilities at own pace. Well, let's have a look at an example, a real life case. And as I said in the beginning, I would like to zoom in on the case of AkzoNobel. Maybe first to set the scene a bit, when we talk about the company AkzoNobel and the IBP journey, we talk about a multinational company being active in over 80 countries with 60,000 different customers, managing a portfolio of over 330,000 products, and also having very complex multi-level hierarchies, both on the product dimension as well on the geographical dimension. The solution we offered, and also what they were looking for, was to have something available on a global scale for over 100 users in 5 business units across 4 regions to make a 48-month plan in monthly buckets. And actually, the main business question that they had was, we need to boost the effectiveness of our S&OP and IBP. And for them, one of the first building blocks was to step up in the demand planning domain. And so the question of at hand was how to quickly come to a global harmonized demand planning solution, balancing best fit statistics, but also exception-based planning. And that started with a process design. A process design on, okay, but how should an effective demand planning cycle look like? And that's something what you see reflected in this circle. A demand planning cycle that starts every month with data quality validation. Do I have the right data? Is it consistent? Is it complete? Then second step, cleansing and preparation of data, followed by a segmentation. A segmentation based on the example you saw in one of the previous slides. And after segmentation, look for ways to generate the best fit statistical baseline. In many cases, starting with traditional time series models, but in other cases, upgraded with machine learning models. When a statistical baseline is available, you typically combine it with actionable insights to steer planning behavior and also continuous improvement guidance. How can you do it better? And for that, typically visualization tools are used. But then still, as last step, you need one platform, a global platform that can support that to consolidate and prepare the demand meetings. And for that consolidation and preparation of the demand meeting, the JEDEX platform was configured. So how did that look like from a data flow perspective? Actually, we connected to the ERP layer of AkzoNobel. We got data in, it was exchanged and stored in secured environments. Then in a data science platform that we have labeled Honeycomb, actually all the analytics works was done and the data processing and the data cleansing. And based on that, we generated best fit statistical forecasts. Best fit statistical forecasts that were uploaded, connected into the JEDEX platform for review, for enrichment, and for consolidation. And obviously, in every cycle, this got supported also with actionable insights and reports. Then after review and enrichment and consolidation, a snapshot of the latest plan was taken and it was fed back to ERP systems as an input to their IBP meetings and also supply planning cycle. But let's zoom in then on how did that look like. This is a snapshot I took from the demand plan book, where you can see actually it's quite user friendly. On top, you see total demand, but depending on the selections you make, it immediately drills down up to the level of potentially even individual products. And I think the strength of this solution was that planners could do any forecast enrichment, both on aggregated as well as individual demand forecasting unit level. The view also immediately showed portfolio segmentations. What are my new products? What are my end-of-life products? And it added the label for the ABC XYZ classifications that you saw in the beginning. But it also included proactive alerts that steered the behavior of planners to review those items where the system spotted specific trends or risks in the forecast. Another important element in this plan book is that it's not only about reviewing and enriching numbers, but maybe even more important, also to capture the business assumptions behind. Because especially those business assumptions are an important input to the demand, S&OP and IBP cycle. And because if a plan changes or gets adapted, it's not only that you want to see the revised forecast, but especially you want to see the business assumptions behind. Because that's something you can reflect upon. That's also something you can evaluate in the next planning cycle when actuals might turn out to be different than what you initially planned for. So the first screenshot was about reviewing and enriching the forecast from a volume perspective. But we also added the possibility to multiply the volumes with prices, average selling price. And also there, you could do a kind of enrichment. So it was not a single average selling price that was being used, but that ASP could be changed over time, depending on, for instance, new price positioning, catalog prices, or even promotional activities that they might have. And also there, next to adjusting the price, important to capture the assumptions behind. Why did I adjust my price? Last, after reviewing and enriching the plan, it's also about consolidating the plan, seeing the total picture. Where's my business going in terms of volume, but also in terms of revenue? And having that visibility, both on the total consolidated level, as well on a more detailed level, either per region, per business unit, in their case, even on warehouse level. That all being set up in the JEDX environment, where we actually connected all regions from AkzoNobel, in some cases also making use of different data sources. So what did it bring to them? It started with that question on how to quickly come to a harmonized solution across the globe, balancing best fit statistics with exception-based planning. And what we implemented was a monthly state-of-the-art statistical baseline forecast service, including portfolio segmentation, making use of JEDX, and that resulted immediately in forecast performance increase and synchronization of demand planning activities. Implementation in Europe done within 3 months, and the rollout to full global scope, those four BUs in, or five BUs in four regions, within 9 months. And actually, already after the first months, you saw performance improving. Forecast accuracy going up. Actually, already after a few months, you saw that the accuracy of the statistical forecast was outperforming the final forecast. But also a substantial improvement in forecast bias. So actually, the total volumes that got forecasted. So I think in that sense, a nice example. Yep, Sam?
Yeah, sorry, thank you. I have another question coming up. It says, implementation in less than 3 months. Is that because this is a standard solution, or is this including customizing? And it's, I'm assuming this is asking about hierarchies, for instance, product groups.
Yeah, it's a good question. It's including customization. Actually, the way it works is that we always start with a proof of concept. We start with it, let's say, a standard configuration in that proof of concept. And based on interaction, we start tuning it, start customizing it. And especially, for instance, in the type of views you would like to have, or hierarchy structures you would like to reflect, that always requires customization, because you want to make sure that the views you build, the dashboards you build, are fit for purpose for your business. And that's really key to make sure that the solution is being used in practice, but also it helps to get a fast adaption of this new solution. Good question. To summarize, boost high quality decision making in your S&OP and IBP. Advanced analytics as a service enables companies to spend valuable time in their S&OP on the core of what is needed, focused and exception based decision making. And that advanced analytics as a service allows you to instantly connect to proven analytics, but also to make sure that you can grow your planning capability at own pace. And maybe most important, you start harvesting the business benefits from the start. Increased revenue, improved profitability, and as also quite often, inventory levels get impacted, they get more healthy, so cash conversion cycle improves a lot. I think that basically summarizes, concludes my story of today. I think we have some time left, Sam, for Q&A.
Yes, definitely. So if there are any questions left, please make sure to put them in the question box and then. Maybe while everybody is thinking about if there are any questions, I had a question myself. What about security? How do you deal with potential critical data, for instance?
Yeah, that's a good question, Sam, because I think for all companies we work for, making that step to outsourcing part of your business planning process is a conscious decision to take. And data security and how do you care about my data is an important element in that. In that sense, all the systems we use are obviously secured. Also, the way we organize authorizations internally in the team, but also the way we have set up the data exchange to systems at customer side, it all happens in a very secure environment. And the same applies, by the way, also with the connections we make with the JEDOX environment and the tool that is being set up there.
Great, thank you. While we wait for maybe one or two questions to come in still, if there is anybody who wants to know a bit more, please feel free to ask the question. Maybe from my side also, lastly, I could imagine the participants thinking, okay, this is all good and well, but why would we consider outsourcing a part of our business planning process?
Yeah.
Why not handle it ourselves?
Yeah, it's, I think if I reflect on the companies we work for where we offer this solution, actually always this was part of the discussion, can't we do this ourselves? And then you see, we basically say, but if you are in an urgent need to make steps now, and in many cases, it was either that they lacked the people to do it, or the tools, or they were in urgent need of performance improvement, you said, okay, let us take care of this. We become a part of your process. We follow your planning cycle. I think that's important. In that sense, it's always the planning cycle of the customer that is leading. But by outsourcing this part, it's a kind of temporary setup to give you time to build up your own planning capability. And that I think in that sense, that has proven to work, that we follow the cycles, that we work according to very clear SLAs as well in delivering the output data to make sure that also that flow, that planning flow, runs really smoothly.
Okay, great. Final call for any further questions from the participants. I see one more question coming in. Connecting to the question regarding implementation time, how much business effort is required? An example, the company's own resources. Excellent question.
Yeah, that's a good question. Actually, I would almost label it as a kind of light effort at business side, at company side. And so doing these kind of implementations, yes, it requires data to be shared. So there will be a workshop, a session on agreeing on data templates. There will be one, two design sessions to make sure that customization requirements get clear. But actually, all the work to configure the systems, to also find the best fit analytics to get that done, that's mainly done at planning services side. And it applies both for the data analytics side as well as the customization of the JEDOX tool, for instance. So it's mainly involvement in the early stage, and I would say in the acceptance stage, obviously, where you have acceptance testing and handover to make sure that the cycle starts running.
Hopefully that answers your question. Any other questions before we wrap up? Now is the time. Joost, I want to thank you for your presentation. Good stuff. Thanks everybody for joining the session today. I think with concluding this webinar, we've won 15 minutes of our day back. We appreciate you being here. Thanks again. And if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to us afterwards. Have a nice day.
Thank you.